Up, you see my screen and go to put the slides up. Good. The topic, this topic for us today is logistic regression. So let's look at a binary classification problem, which is essentially like a binary prediction problem. We have two classes or two labels to be predicted. And let's look at the case where we are attempting this problem with a linear regression model, right? So you've got two classes, points belong to two classes here. So the plus classes and the circle classes, and we are fitting a line, which is essentially the linear regression model. And you can see that if what you call the value, which is computed for a point over on this side of the line, if it is or the hyperplane is greater than will be greater than one and greater than zero, and will be like this side of the line will be greater than whatever will be less than zero, right? Essentially, like you can look at the two sides of the hyperplane. If it is W transpose X plus B is equal to zero, W transpose plus B greater than zero will mark the plus classes, and less than zero will mark the circle classes. So that's how you can use a linear regression model to do a prediction, right, in a binary classification context or a binary prediction context. So all I want to make here, and the comment that I want to make here, is linear regression model. What we do in a linear regression model is, as we have already seen in the last session, we use the principle of least squared error, or minimizer will be the sum of residuals, the squared residuals, right? We fit in the best line or best hyperplane, which with the principle of least squared error minimizer, we call it least square error what you call a regression or least squared regression model, and that's what we have done. There's an issue with this least squared regression model. So how do we pick the line or find the best hyperplane representing the set of XI, YI relationship? We will use, we'll minimize the residuals, primarily the squared residuals, right? And when we do that, we are trying to look for that line which is essentially like minimizing the square distance. So for example, if you're considering this point, so the point is actually represented by a point over here in the line which we have constructed. So what's the distance between this actual point, basically like the y value of this point, and this, if this x x dimension and this is the y dimension, so what is the difference between the what you call the this point and the point which is essentially like, say if you are considering this particular x value, say for example here, so corresponding this x value, the line says y should be here, or the our regression model says corresponding this particular x value, the regression model says y is over here, right? But the actual y given for this particular x point is this. So there's a distance between, this is called, we call that the residual. We square it up and we try to minimize that. So we'll find the best line which suits all the training points. If these are the training points that we have in this context of a linear regression model, we'll fit the line which minimizes what you call the squared distance between the predicted value of y and the actual value of y given in x, right, for which the x is defined in the training data. That's what we do. And that's called the residual, basically least squared error regression model. Right? That's what we have seen in the last class. When we do that, consider a case where we have outliers. Say, for example, I've got a circle over here. I've got two or three circles over here and some, what you call, and then two or three plus over here, plus points over here, and assume that this circle is far off from the rest of the circles. These two or three circles, or one circle for that matter, is far off. It's somewhere here. All right. So what will happen? What will happen to the best fit line? So what is going to happen is, like, in order to accommodate this circle, this line will actually like move in this direction, right? Basically, it'll rotate and probably like come a little down, and then. So it may go somewhere here, it may go, it can even go somewhere here, right? And we know that this is actually a circle. See, think of another context. This circle crosses the boundary and then goes over here. What will happen? Then the line, in order to accommodate that line, may actually like kind of, what do you call, may shift over here and then See, all the circles are over here and some of the plus points are misclassified. So essentially what I want to say is, if there are outliers which are a little far off, outliers are points, I mean, if there are points which are a little far off, or if there are points which are outliers, what is going to happen with a least squared error regression model is, it'll actually like pull the line in that direction of the outliers. So least squared regression model is not robust to outliers. That's one of the major problems with least squared regression model. So can we, and why it's happening? Because we are giving importance to, when you minimize, when you look at the cost function, we are giving importance to the distance between the point and the actual distance between the point, which is basically the y value, and what you call the y value of the given by the teacher, and the y value given by the line, primarily the regression line. All right. So essentially, you are giving importance to the notion of distance, right? Why do you have to give it? I mean, why do you have to respect? Say, for example, there are many points over here, and there are points closer to the boundary, there are points far from the boundary. Why do you have to give importance to the notion of distance while fitting the best hyperplane or the line or the regression line, that matter? And this thought led to, right, led to the scientists thinking over, or mathematicians thinking over, a model that respects the correct classification, right? Our interest, say we are looking at a binary classification problem, and if we are trying to do that with the linear regression model, we will not, I mean, if there are outliers, then the regression model will not be robust to outliers, and it'll actually like take the line away from the most of the, what do you call, most of the points which are dense in nature. The outlier may actually make the line ill fit for the corresponding classification problem. So for example, if the line is moving in this direction, some of the pluses will go to the other side of the line, right? Which says that even on the training data, you don't have the right fit. So outliers can affect, why do we, and that's happening only because the distance is taken into consideration while computing the cost, right? Cost of fitting the best line. So that led to, like, can we just think of the correct classification, because our agenda is a prediction or binary classification, and can we think of a model that correct classification can be given importance over the conventional notion of computing the distance between the actual and the predicted, right? And that led to this kind of a cost function, right? I said, can we just look at, say, some of you may remember this particular context. If yi, our class labels are given, the label class labels are marked as -1 and +1, you know that a correct classification, this is basically the model. Model is parameterized by w. Given xi, it will give you f of w comma xi, which is essentially the prediction. If there is a correct classification on the minus class, f of x w comma xi will be less than 0. Right, it will be negative, and the actual label is also negative. So if there is a correct classification, in the case of points labeled as -1 into a negative number is greater than 0, right? So likewise, if the correct if you are trying to predict a point belonging to the plus class, plus into the correct prediction will result in a positive value, which means that +1 into a positive value will be greater than 0. So correct classification will always end up in yi into f of w comma xi, which is essentially the prediction, greater than or equal to 0. So can we look at a cost function which penalizes this kind of a notion? Can we look at a cost function where irrespective of the distance, can we just look at the cost of misclassification? And this led to people looking at the logistic regression model. Logistic regression model is essentially like, it uses the sigmoid or the logistic function. If you look at this function, if these are all the plus classes and these are all the O classes, right? And the function is basically like, I mean, you can sort of linear in this. So if this runs between 0 and +1, and beyond a point, like, I mean, it's basically like it could convert this to over what you call over the negative side of the x-axis, this converges to 0, and the positive side, this converges more of an s-curve, and on the positive side of the x-axis, this converges to a +1. So it basically like runs and gives you a value between 0 and 1, and it's sort of what you call, So what happens here is, I mean, if you look at it, so essentially what it says is, for any value of x beyond any positive value of x beyond a particular point, or basically like when as x goes high, the value of y which converges to one, so it doesn't matter, right? You're interested only in making sure that values clip, because you're looking at a binary classification problem. The values are clipped at or positioned at a 0 and a 1. So we can look at this as a 0-1 classification context, where one of the label can be 0, other label can be 1, and beyond, see, whatever be the value of x, beyond a point, it hits 1 and then it remains there, and below certain values of x, it converges to a 0. That's what it is. That's what the shape of the function is. And this goes very well with our problem here. So for example, if I've got a huge value of x, what will happen is, like, and this line can get extended and you get a very high value of y. And if you have got this y value in the training point, if it's somewhere out here, things would have been like, the line would have shifted to a direction and probably translated so that the rest of the points are not at all given importance. So rather, let us not give over importance to the value of y, because our interest is whether the y is right or not, right? The predicted y is right or not. And we are interested in a binary classification problem. So our y is limited to a 0 and 1 beyond certain absolute values of x. Let these values be converged to a 0 and a 1, right? That's a desirable property, because there you're clipping the values to the desired set of values, which is a high and a low. And that's a desirable property of logistic function, which is also called a sigmoid function, right? That's the reason why they move on to a logistic function as a good way to represent the y value corresponding to x. Right, the y value. Look at it. The problem, given any x, you have got a y value, and if y grows or decreases indefinitely, then there is an issue, which is essentially creating that the fitness and the problem with the robustness of the function which we fit with the regression, the linear regression model. Let us clip the y values, and beyond a particular value of x, it goes stays at 1, and below a certain value of x, it stays at 0. That's what it is. That's a desirable property. So people said, yes, logistic function or the sigmoid function is a good candidate. It's a good candidate to address the problem of robustness, because large y values are creating that robustness problem, and let us clip the values to the desired two levels, right? So logistics gives you an interesting curve in that dimension, right? Let's go back, relook at our old Bayesian classification model. What does a Bayesian classification model do? Bayesian classification is essentially about converting prior probability along with the class condition density to a posterior probability. Your posterior is essentially like, given the values for a set of features, how do you predict the label, right? So essentially you are looking at posterior distribution, right? So what the problem that the, and I told you, logistic regression is essentially used in the case of a binary classification context, where we have context like a spam and a non-spam, a person who is affected, not affected, good or bad, loyal customer, not loyal customer, or so. This is a kind of context. We have binary classification problems, and in the case of binary classification problems, let's consider the labels as 0 and 1, because that's a way in which a sigmoid really considered. Let's label the two classes as class 0 and class 1, and can we directly model the logistic regression? When people wanted to apply the regression model in the case of a binary the binary classification context, the first question they ask is, rather than say in the case of naive Bayesian classifier, you may see that You will try to model the probability of x. It's basically probability of y, which is essentially the a priori probability of a class. If there are two classes, 0 and 1, you essentially compute the prior probability of 0, prior probability of 1. Then you have what we call conditioned over the class. Say, given 0, what is the probability of observing a particular feature? Say, for example, a particular word. So this is called class conditions. You get a lot of such features. So you essentially assume class condition independence, and then you, what you do is using condition independence, you multiply and you get the class conditional densities. Using class condition densities and the prior probabilities, you convert that to posteriori probabilities with the help of a Bayesian rule. That's what is happening in the naive Bayesian classifier. So essentially, you are building the probability values from which you can sample more points, right? You're essentially building a generative model. Essentially, you have modeled all the densities with which, say, for example, given 0, given class 0, I know like what are the probability of observing a particular feature, right? You know that. That's where the class conditional densities, which means that I can sample from the distribution and generate as many x's I want. I can generate data given the class, right? So essentially, I have a model with which I'll be able to generate data, and such modeling techniques are typically called generative models. Instead, in the logistic regression, what we are trying to do is we are trying to use the notion of regression to achieve classification. Rather than looking at the prior probabilities or class condition densities, can we directly look at the posterior probabilities? That's a question that logistic regression asked. They said, let's assume that. So we were, in the case of linear regression model, we had a problem with the robustness because of the least square regression model. And we have addressed that by saying, let's have a curve which gives clipped values of y. The y varies over only between say 0 and 1 in the case of sigmoid, and which is basically like bounded, and then that too happens only over bounded values of x. And so we have got a nice function to deal with. So can we just presume that? Can you, you may remember our context of likelihood estimate. Basically, we were looking at models where the structure of the model is known to us, all right? And we are looking at a classification problem in the case of a logistic regression using a regression modeling. So we are addressing a classification problem using a regression modeling, and our problem, our robustness problem, can essentially be solved using a function like logistic regression. And our problem is classification. Why do we have to model all the underlying probability distribution? Rather, can we just model our actual problem? Our actual problem is essentially the classification, which is basically discrimination between the points belonging to the class 0 and class 1. All right? Can we directly model the posterior probability? And that's where, and they said, yes, let us model the posterior probability of class 1 given a data point. That's what is we are trying to model that in the case of logistic regression. And we said, since sigmoid logistic is a good candidate in that context, let us model that as a logistic function of the linear model which finds the relationship between x and between x and y. So essentially, let's model the posterior probability of finding a 1. Let's call it p1 is equal to 1 by 1 plus e raised to minus w dot x, where w dot x is essentially the dot product between a w vector and the input vector x, right? So given x, how do you model, how do you assume the model, how do you presume the model of that probability distribution? And that's this kind of a context. You may remember that we have done that in the case of likelihood estimations. Let's assume that the probability of 1 or p1 is given x, given the data point, the posterior probability is sigmoid or logistic in nature. All right, I'll come back and make a reverse statement later. So what I'm saying is, let's assume that the model is logistic, the probability model is logistics, and the parameter is w, right? logistic model. The parameter of the logistic model is W, which is essentially a vector representing a linear relationship between what you call it, whatever, right? We are going to see that. Yes, if the moment you assume that's it, for example, and the case you have a two-class classification problems, so probability of one is basically like P1, I represent that as P1 is equal to 1 by 1 plus e raised to minus wx. If that's the case, the probability of the other class P0 will be 1 minus of this, right? 1 minus 1 by 1 plus e raised to minus wx. That's what it is. That's what is presumed there. Right? So if this is the probability of the event of observing class 1, this will be the probability of observing of the event of observing or primarily predicting as class 0, right? So you've got P1 and P0. So let us take the odds ratio of class 1. Odds ratio of class 1, I told you, if your class 1 is turning a head up and your class 0 is turning a tail up in the case of a coin tossing experiment, the odds ratio, or if P is the probability of turning a head up, right, which we labeled as 1, class 1, so the odds ratio of of the event turning the head up will be P by 1 minus P. So let us take the odds ratio, basically like what we essentially do is P by 1 minus P. Let's take the odds ratio for the class 1. So the odds ratio for the class 1 will be P1 divided by 1 minus P. What is 1 minus P? Which is P0. P1 divided by P0, right? P1 divided by 1 minus P, which is P0. P1 by P0, this is called the odds ratio, right? You can see it here. It's called the odds ratio, right? This is called the odds ratio. And I'm taking the log of the odds ratio. So if you look at the log of the odds ratio, so just look at the log of the odds ratio, 1 by 1 plus e raised to minus wx divided by 1 minus 1 by 1 plus e raised to minus wx, which you can see that it'll be equal to 1 by, if you look at this, you can easily see that this term will 1 minus, and a little algebra will show you that it'll be e raised to minus wx x divided by 1 plus c raised to minus wx, and these two things will cancel, so you get 1 by if you take the fraction p1 by p0, you'll see that will be equal to 1 by p1 by p0. You can compute in your notebook, you can see that p1 by p0 will be equal to 1 by e raised to minus wx, which can be written as e raised to wx. And if you take, so which means that the the odds ratio is equal to e raised to wx, the odds ratio, that is p1 by p0, the odds ratio p1 by p0, you can write that the odds ratio p1 by p0 will be equal to e raised to wx, all right? Odds ratio will be e raised to wx. If that is nothing but p1 by p0, right? Which is p1 by 1 minus p1, which is p1 by p0. Odds ratio is equal to p1 by 1 minus p1 will be equal to p1 by 1 minus p0 will be equal to p1 by 1 minus p1 will be equal to p1 by p0 will be equal to e raised to wx is what you get. So L is equal to e raised to wx. L will be like basically the odds ratio, let's call that the odds ratio, or odds ratio is equal to odds ratio for p1 or the class 1, odds ratio will be equal to e raised to wx, and the logit is nothing but the log of the odds ratio. So log of odds ratio will be log of e raised to wx will be equal to wx. So this is what, that's expression that you see over here. So log of p1 by p0, you can easily see that it will be wx. What does it say? The logit of the odds ratio for class 1, for that matter, we can see for class 0 also. So log of the odds ratio, which is defined in the theory of probability, you call that logit. Logit of p1 is equal to wx, which means that, what is the meaning? You have, if p1 is the probability of observing class 1, its logit is linear in x, right? Let me repeat, if p1 is the probability of observing class 1, this is nothing but its logit or log odds ratio, which is observed to be linear in X. W transpose X, which is W is a vector and X is your input. All right. Which says that you can essentially, if we have the notion of X, which is your input, and if we have some clarity over your probability distribution P1 or P0, and by computing the logit or the log odds ratio, you see that your relationship, essentially like your log of the odds ratio, which is logit, is linear in X. What is the observation? What can you do now? Log odds ratio, let's look at an example. All right. In this case, I've got medication dosage, essentially like the kind of dose that they give to patients is 20 units, 30 units, 40 units, and 50 units. And these are the number of people actually cured. And this is the number of people over which, of patients over which you have experimented with. You have given 20 units dosage to 5 patients, out of which 1 cured. And 30 units were given to 6 patients, where 2 cured. And likewise, you gave 6 units, I mean, 6 people were given 40 units, 7 people were given 50 units. And so if you have that, this kind of data, you can essentially compute the probability of getting cured, which we call as P1. Let's call it. We have a 2-class context here, either cured or not cured. And the probability of cure is P1, it'll be equal to 1 by 5.20 for 20 units. And for 50 units, it'll be 6 by 7, it'll be 0.86. So you've got this kind of data, right? This is basically like, and what are you interested in? And you know that the medication dosage, essentially like the number of units that you give, number of units of that medicine that you give to patients will essentially decide the probability value. You've got the independent variable, the dosage values, and the dependent variable, the probability of getting cured, right? That's what it is. And given any another dose, say for example 35 or DOS-10, can I predict? Can you build a relationship between these two? All right? Can you build a relationship between these two? Given you have the probability of getting cured, which is P1, I can compute the odds ratio P by 1 minus P, right? P by 1 minus P will be equal to, you can see that P by 1 minus P.20 divided by 1 minus what do you call 1 minus 0.20, 0.8, 0.25. You get this, you can compute the odds ratio, right? Basically the odds of this probability values. You compute the odds, and you can also compute the log odds. You can compute the log odds. It's nothing but the logarithm, natural logarithm of P by 1 minus P, right? Now, what we have seen from here? The log odds ratio is linear in X. What is X in our case? In our case, X is this, right? X is this, is the independent variable, and this is our Y, right? And you've got the probability for the class of cured, right? And you've got the corresponding log odds ratio, and you've got the corresponding odds ratio, and you've got the corresponding log odds ratio. What does this equation say? The moment you presumed a sigmoid structure for that probability, all right, if the moment you assume that this is logistic, the probability, the structure of the probability distribution is logistics, you see that the log odds ratio is linear in X. Which says that the relationship between this X and this log odds ratio is linear. So if X is this and this is its log odds ratio, let's call it L. The relationship between X and L is linear, all right? Which means that L, if we call this particular, basically the log odds ratio as L, L can be written as L is equal to log of P1 by P0 is equal to W dot X, which means that L can be, we don't know how to model the relationship between the actual thing P1 or the Y, but we have L is equal to W dot X. You have a context where we find that the relationship between X and the log odds ratio is linear in nature, right? This is interesting. So let us learn that using a linear regression model. So the moment we identify this relationship, what you can do? You can fill it in, right? You can say L is equal to 10. So they call it Y. Let's call it L is equal to the log. So ratio L is equal to whatever, right? Let's not put capital L. Let's put small L here. Small L is equal to 11.x-3.x. So essentially, you can actually fit in a relationship between the x and the log salts ratio, and you do that. Once you have that, the log salts ratio is equal to, you can fit a line between for the relationship between x and the log salts ratio. That's what you do here. The moment you have this, you know L, right? And you know the relationship between what you call x and L. Right, L is equal to W dot X. Right, what is L? L is W dot X. Right, so now I know the relationship between L and X. Interesting, I got a line fitting this. Right, this is straightforward. You can do that. This you can do with a linear regression model. The relationship between X and L can be decided with a linear regression model. You do that. Right, you have a regression line connecting logos or the logit and the input independent variable x, right? Once, now I need to compute the probability value p for a dosage of 10. I want to compute this particular value, the p value, the probability value for say another dosage, say 15, 20, 25, whatever. I'm taking an example 10. So what I can do, I can actually compute the log of the audit. I know the relationship between, I can compute L, the logit value for that particular x. So logit value for 10 will be 0.11 into 10, right? Basically, and minus 3.8, so you get minus 2.7 as my logit value. The moment I have L or W dot X, what is P? What is P? P, we have presumed P is 1 by 1 plus e raised to minus W dot X, or P is equal to 1 by 1 plus e raised to minus L. All right, what do I do? I can compute the probability value for the x 10 as is equal to 1 by 1 plus e raised to minus 2.7. I get this value. You got it? So what do we do in logistic regression? Let me make a reverse statement. I can presume the structure of the model. Right, the structure, we are considering a binary classification context. We can presume that the probability distribution for the class that we are considering is logistic in nature. The moment you have that, with that probability assumption, we will see that the odds ratio will be linear, L will be linear in X. Right, if that's linear in X in logistic regression model, we can fit in a relationship between the independent variable X and the log odds ratio or the logit. Once you have the logic, you know that the model is basically, you have got the parameters of the model, which means that we got the linear relationship between. So essentially, this W in the logistic regression model is essentially the relationship which connects what you call the logic and the independent variable, right? Logic of the probability distribution, the independent variable. So the moment you have learned W, you can put it back into this equation and you get what you call it, the corresponding probability value, which is essentially the prediction that you want to make. All right, so let me read what you call, make the same statement of logistic regression, the concept of logistic regression, different dimension. If we assume that if P is the probability of the class that we are considering, and P, the moment you have P by 1 minus P is its odds ratio, log of P by 1 minus P will be its logit. All right, if the logit of P is linear in, if the logit of P, let me repeat, if the logit of P is linear with the independent variable X, which means that if L is equal to W dot X, where X is the independent variable, if L, the logit of the class that we are considering, of the event that we are considering, which is basically the occurrence of the class, if the logit of the occurrence of the class of the event is linear in the linear in the independent variable X, which means that L is equal to W dot X. right? You can write down in that a piece of paper. If L is equal to W dot X, what is L? L is equal to W dot X. L is equal to log of P by 1 minus P is equal to W dot X. Log of P by 1 minus P is equal to W dot X. Right? Now you can write P by 1 minus P is equal to E raised to W dot X. P by 1 minus P is equal to E raised to WX. Compute for P. You can see that P will be equal to 1 by 1 plus E raised to minus WX. That's essentially the relation. So essentially, if P is the probability of an event, its odds ratio is P by 1 minus P, its logit is log of P by 1 minus P, right? The inverse of the logit is nothing but logistic or sigmoid. So I'll make this statement. If we assume that given the occurrence of the class 1 as the event and its probability value is P, and its logit or log of the odds ratio is linear in the independent variable, which means that L is equal to W dot X, we can say that P will be 1 by 1 plus E raised to minus W dot X, because the inverse of the logit is logistic, right? And that's why logistic regression works, right? And this is the principle of logistic regression. So how do you do logistic regression? All you need to do is basically you look at your data table, you compute the logic, the log odds ratio, fit in a relationship between the X and the log odds ratio, then your probability will be 1 by 1 plus e raised to minus W dot X, because the logit and the logistic regression is essentially they're connected, and the relationship is the inverse logit is essentially, if P is the probability of an event, the inverse logit, its inverse logit or inverse of its logarithm of the odds ratio will be logistic or sigmoid, right? So your P will be equal to, from that you can compute P as 1 by 1 plus E raised to minus W dot X. This is the idea of logistic regression. I want to stop our recording over here, and we can have a discussion if there's a need for it.